friends, I'm DJ Lance Rock, and I have to say, Rock and Roll Grad School is awesome!
This is Rock and Roll Grad School with your hosts, Heidi Hedquist and Luke Poling. First-time callers, long-time listeners.
Dirty Mind, Dirty World. Track two, Dirty World.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. That's how they sang that song. He just made that crap up.
Well, and let's make it volume three just to confuse everybody. Just to be like, wait, did we miss
that
something?
Was genius.
It was genius.
It was genius. I mean, Tom was a freaking genius, I gotta tell you right now. I've never been with a guy. I worked with a lot of different bands, you guys, and I've never seen anybody like Tom Petty. I've never seen any fans as big as his that are just completely awestruck. And I just got through watching Air Jordan again for the second time. So there's a guy wants to do something based on my book.
Nice.
And I'm going to watch Air Jordan. I watched it again.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. It was the same exact thing.
Well, but the thing that's interesting, and I think Heidi will agree with me, and I think it comes through in every page of this book, and it goes back to the faxes and there is a love of the music and what you're doing, and there is a playfulness that, again, the faxes talk about it. Even the way the first night you met him, where he kicks you out of the green room because he's like, you're not getting us played on LA radio. Good luck, buddy. Like, there's just such a, again, a playfulness and an idea of like, let's have fun and just be ridiculous that really comes through the book. And it sort of seems like that's maybe the thing that connected the two of you over time, was that you guys just like playing together.
We love playing together. I mean, you know, when the night we went over to the college and the cop pulled us over.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh God, I'm going to get fired. Ocean Man driving, and Tom Petty smoking pot. And but no, we had this playfulness together because he was one of the nicest guys you would ever want to meet. I mean, seriously. Cool. He would come up to your face sometimes. You go to his house and just to listen to records. I'd take records over to his house to listen to. And he'd come to the front door and he'd go, oh, it's Sizzling Memphis Natural Jon Scott. Come on in. He said, I bet I can make you laugh. I go, no. Rutabaga. Rutabaga. Watermelon. he just would crack up. I mean, he was so crazy. And some of his songs, I mean, think about them. They're playful.
Yeah.
There's so much. Yeah. The jokes in there. The only one that can think of off the top of my head is from the She's the One soundtrack about, I saw you kick the dog when the wind blew off your wig or something like that.
Oh.
You know?
I've got so many little IDs from him, those Christmas IDs. You've heard of those, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean,
God, there's one that I was going to bring it up, and the book is like right next to me, and I'm like, I need to like use this to sign off every Christmas everything, and I've forgotten which one it is. I'm going to grab it and tell you guys in a minute, but it was brilliant.
Which one, the ID?
Yes, hold on, I'm going to grab it.
They did them all different.
Mm-hmm. And those were all, do you I didn't see them on the website.
I remembered what it is. May all your Cabbage Patch Kids be intact, remain intact. I was like, how have I not thought of this myself?
Your Cabbage Patch style looks like, what does he say? Your Cabbage Patch style looks
like. Missing a leg. It opened with your Cabbage Patch style was missing a leg.
Yeah, it looks
and then it closes with may all your Cabbage Patch styles remain intact.
Accurate. It looks like Tony Curtis.
Yeah.
Tony Curtis, Tom, where did you come up with that? Learning to Fly, I believe. Free Falling. And he had this one lick that he kept playing over and over for weeks. His wife would go, shut up. Stop it. His family's kids were, stop it, Dad, stop it. And then he couldn't get it. And he said one night, the Muse just, he held his hand out and the Muse dropped his song in his hands. And Jeff Lynne came over the next day and said, okay, let me hear that riff. And he started doing it. And he told Tom, just make up some lyrics. And he goes, let's see, how does it start off?
She's a good girl.
She's a good girl, loves her mother. And he goes, that's good. That's good. Loves horses and Jesus too. That's real good. Keep going. I'm a bad boy because I don't even miss her. That's good. Loves horses and American too. What's the other one?
Crazy about Elvis.
Huh?
Yeah, crazy about Elvis.
Mm-hmm. Crazy about Elvis. He said, that's really good. And so that's how the song evolved. It's like, but Jeff Lynne is a genius. I mean, he got so much out of Tom. But Tom was a fan of his. Tom is a student of music. He really was a student of music. And going back to the Zombies and the Rolling Stones, of course, and the Beatles, and then to the Birds. And he was like, you know, Roger McGuinn said, after he heard American Girl, Roger McGuinn said, did I write that song? Roger, I don't know if you saw it in the book, but Roger McGuinn's, I think it's in my book. No, maybe not. He wrote me I sent him a book and he wrote back, I love your book, signed it Roger McGuinn. It's one of those faxes. Oh yeah, that's in the book.
He
didn't do the review of my book. He just said, thanks for the fax demo. Uh-huh.
Yes.
Which was awesome.
I became good friends with him. Him and his wife are gourmet cooks, and come to Tom's house and just stay for a week and cook.
I love the faxes are like, just checking to see if this works.
Yeah.
Is it working?
And the other thing that's shocking, so I want to make sure we have enough stuff to really sell the book, because it's a lot of fun. It's really enjoyable. So you started
my book real quick is I think I wrote it. I didn't make it a 600 page book, and I didn't want. I wanted mm-hmm. it to be print where you could read it. I've got a book now called Tone Chaser. It's great, but mm-hmm. it's 600 pages, and the lyrics are like this big. And like it takes me a night and a half to get through half a chapter.
Well, just to climb into bed with the thing takes a while. Yeah, I hear you.
5 pounds.
Yeah. And this is something that
I didn't want to get into the childhood stuff, and I just want to write to get to the point.
Well, it's your story together.
Mm-hmm.
It's about it's not just Tom, it's you two together. That's amazing.
If I hadn't gotten fired at MC because of Johnny Cougar, I would have never met Tom Petty.
Right.
And I look back at it as I tried so hard for Johnny Cougar, and I was supposed to get fired. I was supposed to.
Yeah.
I really was. Mm-hmm. If I hadn't met, I would never met Tom Petty. And if Clive Davis hadn't turned him down for Dwight Twilley, I would have never met Tom Petty. And you know, Clive Davis is supposed to be the man with the golden ears, and he is. He's great. But we took Dwight Twilley because Tom's record wasn't doing anything. That's true, but I wasn't there yet.
Right.
Well, and that's the thing that amazes me. And it happens twice in his story, in your story, that you hear the first record with no label on it and go, this is an amazing record. This has got Breakdown and American Girl.
American Girl, yeah.
And then you jump ahead, what was it 10, 15 years, and Tom plays you Full Moon Fever, and you go, my God, this is brilliant. And again, the label's like, could you maybe put a single on there? Like, that record's nothing but A-sides, just back to back to back to back.
Yeah, he said, we got a problem. What do you mean you got a problem? He said, this is one of the greatest effing records you've ever done, Tom. And he went, we got a problem with what? He said, well, the record company wants us to go back in and do more songs because they don't think there's any hits on it. And I just looked at him like, what?
Yeah.
This is one of the greatest records you've ever done, Tom. And he asked me, well, you knew somebody at MCA. Maybe you read this in the book. You know somebody at MCA. Would you help? And I'm like, sure, I'll help. Good God. I brought the guy over from, it was a new head of album promotion, the job that I had. He was from Buffalo, and he came over. He had been bugging me. He just got to town, and he'd been bugging me about him meeting Tom. And so I said, you know, I'll take care of this, Tom. Oh, I tried to anyway. And I brought him over the next night, and he does the same thing. He's like, God almighty, Tom, that's one of the greatest records you've ever done. Same thing. Well, we have a problem. And the guy goes, what's the problem? Your record company doesn't want to put it out as it is. Wants us to go back in the studio. And he's going, what? And in the book, I described to this guy as he was a great promotion guy, but he was a little crazy, but that's good. Nothing wrong being crazy. Yeah. you had to be almost crazy in that business. But he just jumped up and down on the conference room table saying, who the hell doesn't think there's a hit on this damn record? Get this record out now. And it came out within 3 weeks after that. And and it's a great record. I remember sitting there listening. He had me sitting, listening to speakers. And maybe this is in the book. I'm sorry. I don't know. But I was listening. And when Free Fall came on, I felt like I was gliding over Mulholland, man. It was like flying.
I feel that way every time I hear it.
I'm like just in space. And it was one of the most incredible feelings I'd ever had, because we were up, you know, in his house, and San Fernando Valley was over the hill. And it's like the lyrics of that song are genius, and they're kind of
brilliant
too. But I think every song, you know, every song in his repertoire has the band comes in at the right time. Ben Mott comes in, Mike Campbell comes in and gives the most incredible guitar solos you've ever heard. Mm-hmm. And it was so cohesive. He's an American treasure.
It's amazing that the way the dice rolled, or whatever it is, that you heard that record and then sort of took it upon yourself to, damn it, I'm going to make this guy a Hall of Famer for a venue that hasn't been invented yet. And but you knew of him prior to hearing the first record.
True. But I didn't know who he was.
But your connection was simply through the music. You heard it and were like, this is a good single.
Mud Crutch?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I was with Olivia Newton-John. We were driving to Nashville, and I was taking her there to meet a top 40 station. And it was like one of my first days on the job. And I'm going, they're sending Olivia Newton-John to see me. Holy crap. And I got to tell you, you guys can cut all this stuff out, but I met her at the airport. 106 degrees in Memphis, and she said, can I go for a swim? And I went, sure, I'll just read, you know, Billboard. I don't think this is in my book, but and so she said, well, I'll just go change. And it was 106, really humidity, and she comes out in a smoking hot bikini and she's like Olivia and John, right?
Right.
This is nothing sexual at all, but I'm like, whoa, I think I'm gonna like this job. And then she's walking out the door, and she said, oh. I went, what? She said, I dropped my contact lens.
Awesome.
And, so she gets on the floor, and it's a shag carpet hotel room. She gets on the floor, and I'm looking around trying to help her. I'm on the floor, and I look up, and her butt's staring me right in the face. I'm going, I'm going to like this job. Yeah. You know, the Rolling Stones were one of the reasons I was a promotion man.
Really?
Under assistant West Coast promo man. I heard that when I was like 17 years old. I said, well, that sounds like a damn good job. I'm going to DJ. I'm going to be a promotion guy.
Yes.
I mean, anyway, if I get off on tangents, you guys can edit. But
no, know. No, we are the king and queen of tangents over here. So we love tangents.
And again, that's the great thing about the book. Like you said, writing it short,
yes,
getting it to the point. But it is just filled with so many amazing stories that just, I feel like, because you hear promotion guy and, you know, musical genius cross paths.
Mm-hmm.
That's usually maybe a page that you wrote up that right. whole relationship. But right. it's just it every little interaction where you guys, like I said, you had some sort of connection. You got each other. You liked hanging out together. You were more yeah. than happy to do favors for each other. It's just it's the story of a really beautiful friendship.
It's a friendship. It's a yeah. It's a buddy comedy. It's a heartfelt story. It's all of it. It's a friendship story. It's not a even though the business is the incidental side of it.
No, it's supposed to happen. That's the thing.
It's kismet all the way. Mm-hmm. Just all the way. To happen. Yes.
And I was like, well, on to the next adventure. But I didn't know what the next adventure was until the guy from ABC calls me.
Right.
So he makes me do the raise my right hand thing, right? I do it down in Cougarstone again. If we don't have, if we have a band we want to drop, you cannot get involved. I promise you. He said, you're just going to get fired if you do. So don't forget that. And 3 days later, and he tells me to just call my record friends and tell them where I am, because I'm in my job to get records to play on the radio. And he said, just call your record friends. There's no new albums out right now. Just call your record friends and tell them where you are. And then the third day I was there is when I opened my closet and that white album fell down. And I looked at it and wonder who this is. And I pulled out the vinyl and there was nothing on the vinyl. So I'm going, well, hell, who are these guys? Why is it in my closet? And why did it fall down? I don't know. Anyway, so I picked it up and put it on the turntable and listened to it. And I hear Rocking Around With You. I'm kind of going, yeah, that's good. I hear Breakdown. I'm going, whoa. Holy mackerel. I got my hair standing up on my arms, the goosebumps. And then, of course, I hear American Girl. I'm going, good God almighty. I tell my assistant to hold my calls. I'm putting headphones on. And I had it cranked to the max. And if you ever listen to Tom Petty's first album in headphones, the guitars are flying back and forth and the vocals, she was, is flying back across your head in your headphones. And you know what that's like. And so I ran to my boss. I said, who are these guys? And he pulls down the actual album cover and said, John, this is that punk band, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. Right? Wait, what's your name? Tom Petty and Heartbreakers. They're a punk band. This is a rock and roll band, Charlie. Nope, John, it's been out there for 8 months. We spent a lot of money on them. We're going to drop them in 6 weeks. And I'm going, wait a minute. This is one of the greatest records I've ever heard in my life, Charlie. John, here you go again, Johnny Cougar. So I said, just give me 6 weeks to try and call radio stations to get them to play the record. He says, no. I got on my knees and I begged him. I don't care if I get fired, Charlie. Just give me a chance. I have nothing to do right now. Just give me a chance. He said, all right. If you think you can get this unbankable punk band named Tom Petty and Heartbreakers played, I'll kiss your butt on Sunset Strip and throw you a party. I went, okay, good. Great. I accept. And so then I went back to my office and started calling a few radio stations. And the first one was like, is that punk band Tom Petty?
So funny.
Oh my God, they didn't even listen to the freaking record.
Mm-mm.
They didn't even listen. And I called a couple more stations. Same thing. Wasn't that out like 8 months ago? I went, yeah, it was, but we're going to revive it. And they're like, okay. And then I started calling back the stations that had been playing it, which were few, like KSAN in San Francisco. Where are you guys located?
I'm in Detroit.
I'm in Philly, but grew up in Boston. So I was quite excited to see that WBCN was one of the few to get
they were one of the early ones because the guy who was running BCN was at KSAN in San Francisco, and he got moved from KSAN to Boston. So they were playing Tom Petty at KSAN in San Francisco. He moved to Boston. Norm Weiner was his name. And he started playing Tom Petty there. It started getting a little hold. But then Charlie Miner, my boss, who was a top 40 guy, he was an incredible, one of the most incredible promotion men that will ever live. He told the soldiers out in the field that Tom Petty was a punk band, stopped working Tom Petty and worked Marilyn Davis and Billy McCoo's record, top four. And the guy in Boston, Williston Malt was his name, told me, he said, John, we had to stop. He told us to stop working it. Worked Marilyn McCoo and Billy, and also some of their top 40 songs, but they were just told to stop. And that's they stopped. Amazing.
And then you took one of the program directors, or a bunch of them, to the Whiskey to see the band open for one. And this was like, this was one of your many Hail Marys.
Oh, this is a Hail Mary.
Yeah.
I went around the offices asking people to go with me. Nobody's going, John, that record's 8 months old. We know we're dropping them. I don't want to go see Tom Petty at the Whiskey. And I'm like, I've been living this record now for 3 or 4 days in my car at home. I couldn't get it out of my cassette player. And then, except the president of MCA or ABC says, yeah, I'll go. And he's a new guy from, they brought him in from international marketing. He took over the previous president's job. And he said, well, I'll go with you. I don't know much about Tom Petty. And I was great. Can you get any DJs there? Oh, yeah, sure. I can get DJs there. And I called people at KMET, and now we're going to another show. I called Jim Ladd, who just died.
Yeah.
And said, now I'm going, John, going to another show. And I'm like, oh, God, he's going to call my boss is going to call my bluff. And that's when I had the idea to call up Scott Shannon, who you may know who he is. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And ask him if he would be a top 40 DJ for KHJ. Then I asked my buddy who was from Memphis, he worked for RCA. I said, would you come and be Jim Ladd from KMET? Just tell the guy that. And that, as a matter of fact, they said, you know, John, that's such a ballsy move. Will you ever do that for us if we need you? And I was sweating bullets when the president walked in and Scott Shannon gets up and says, Mr. Diener, what's his name? From KHJ. I can't remember his name, Charlie Tuna or something from KHJ. And then my other buddy goes, Mr. Diener, I'm Jim Ladd from KMET, and you're lucky to have this promotion guy. And I'm sweating bullets, man. Oh my God. If he finds out, they're going to kill me.
Right.
And he has to go at 7 o'clock when the band's coming on. He had another appointment. So we went, God. And then, you know, I'm praying that Tom is not a puck man. And there's 15 people in the Whiskey that night. 7 o'clock, he's opening to Blondie. I'm going, please, Lord, don't let him be a punk band. Please. And I mean, in my heart, I knew he wasn't. But anyway, so they came out and they're all looking like really cool, different guys. Man, they're all cool looking. I mean, just Tom had a scarf on, and they were just dressed like the coolness factor. And so I saw Sam from the stage. I'm going, that's good, the Beatles. And he cranked into first song, which was a Chuck Berry song.
It's in the book.
Chuck Berry song, and he just killed it. I mean, the band killed it. And then he did Breakdown, and my buddy, Charlie Kendall, I didn't talk about him. He's the guy who came with me, and he was the one who I went to his house with. And you know that story, right? He goes with me that night, and he leans over and says, I'm going to start playing Breakdown once an hour, every hour on Monday morning, this new station. And like any promotion guy, they put the ad in the back pocket and go, all right, I got an ad here.
Mm-hmm.
And 7:30, he's done, no encore. And we're just sitting there going, what the hell did we just see? It was like, have you guys seen Tom before?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I never got to see him.
Oh, you did though.
6 years of your life.
Mm-hmm.
And
we go, I got to go meet this guy, Tom Petty. So we run upstairs, and there's no security, and he's wiping sweat off his face. And said, "Hey, Tom Petty, my name is Jon Scott. I'm the new head of album promotion at ABC." He went, "Well, go F yourself." What? He said, "Well, your record company's done nothing for 8 months, and
I mean,
you're another guy coming here. You're just another ABC nut job. What are you talking about?" And I said, "Well, you ever heard your record on the radio in Los Angeles?" He said, "No, why?" I said, "Well, you're going to hear it Monday morning on this new station." He went, "Get the F out of here." They've been telling us for 8 months that they're going to do something with us. And they've done nothing. And I'm just, I don't know why I'm saying these things, but I just turn around and go, Tom Petty, I'm just going to break your career wide open. How's that?
Love it.
And then, of course, he stows it back to Stan Lynch, and you probably cut this out, but.
Of all the guys in the band, too.
You know what he stands for? And I went, no, I have no idea. And he was a bunch of seasickers. And I'm going, the whole band's laughing. And I'm just going, wow, that's interesting. ABC. Wow, I never thought of that. And then he just says, points to his roadie's coming over. He's pointing to the door. And I just turned around and said, okay, my name's Jon Scott, Tom. And every time you hear your record on the radio, because I knew it was going to be on the radio, you're going to think of me. And don't you ever forget it. And man, more laughter. The band's laughing. And me and Charlie walk out the door. We knew what was going to happen. When Charlie started playing that record once an hour, every hour. And Wednesday, the following Wednesday, the manager calls me up and says, who are you? I said, well, I'm Jon Scott. He said, what, you pissed off my artist. Why'd you do that? I said, what do you mean pissed him off? He said, well, you said he's going to break his career. ABC's terrible. And you know you can't do that. I said, well, okay, Tony, I'm Jon Scott, and I'm going to break his career. And then Tom called on Friday. My assistant said, Tom Petty's on the phone. I'm kind of going, oh, God, this could go either way. He could be just cursing me out. And he goes, in a southern drawl he had, John, are you serious? You know what you said the other day? Because my friends are telling me they're hearing the record on the radio. I said, Tom, I'm going to break your career wide open. And he goes, can you come into my house tonight? And I went, I'm writing down the directions as fast as I can, right? And I think you, Luke, I think you said earlier something about that. I get there and we go outside and we get to the point, right?
Mm-hmm. If you will, yeah.
Well, you know, kids sometimes write, so you guys smoked a lot of pot in this book. And I said, well, it was the 70s. That's all I can say. It was the 70s. Tom wasn't a cocaine freak or anything like that. Just we like to smoke pot, whatever. And, it, you know, to me, it makes you more creative. Your ears kind of stand out a little bit. I mean, anyway, not really, but.
As you're talking about seeing him and saying to him repeatedly, I'm going to break your career. Remember my name. Did you ever have a moment of doubt where you kind of like by yourself, where you're going, oh God, what if I don't like, you're still a little burned after the Johnny Cougar incident.
Well, I was happy. Actually, I was happy. I believe in this kid.
And again, that's the thing. I think that like I said, that comes through the book, obviously more with Tom than with Mr. Cougar, but the love and appreciation of these artists and what they, you kind of see what they're trying to give to the rest of us and making sure everyone gets it. I know the book just came out, so I hate to ask this question, but selfishly, what do you say?
It's been out for a while.
I just read this book and selfishly,
it's new.
Yeah, brand new to me. But selfishly, is there another one coming out?
Well, before this, I was writing stories with my buddy, a promotion guy named Wayne McManus, and we were going to call the book Promo Men. Oh. And I've got stories about traveling with The Who. And if you ask me, what was it like traveling with Keith Moon? I will tell you. I'll take another time to tell you this story. And then I traveled with Lynyrd Skynyrd. I have no idea how I can tell you what it was like traveling with Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Oh.
We're absolutely Southern boys who, they had it down, man. They kill people with Freebird. But they would fight each other at Strawberry. Oh. They'd fight anybody.
I bet.
Pretty, yeah. I heard Mel got the other day on Red TV. He was talking to some interviewer. And he said, you know, I used to get high and drink whiskey and go into a bar and look for the biggest guy I could find, and I'm going to fight him. And the guy goes, what do you mean? He said, well, this is what I wanted to do. I was liquored up, I was high, and I want to fight somebody. He said, I would always lose. But that was John Mellencamp. I mean, I'm way off target.
No, it's all, it, it's all wonderful. And the book is a lot of fun. And we always, when we give any of our guests this much of a tongue bath, we always say, like, we don't do this with everybody.
We don't.
If the book is good, if the record's good, we will, we'll be very polite about it. But if we really like it, we respond appropriately. And
he is an American treasure. You know that, Tom is.
He definitely is. And I think the biggest compliment I can give you with this book is that, one, when you're talking about having them do the session at Capitol Records, where they, you bring in all the DJs to hear the band live, and you had them do a cut of Breakdown that you then sent out.
Because it's never been done live before, and that's the record we were trying. Breakdown came out in 1976 as a single and did nothing.
Again.
About a year and a half later, after we'd done the Breakdown live thing, and it made it to number 40 on the charts.
It's so amazing.
I don't know of any other record in my life. I mean, maybe there is, but it's been out for 8.5 months, and all of a sudden it's selling nothing. And then now he's now 80 million records.
Right? That's just nuts.
And can you think of another album that sets, I don't, maybe there is, but I can't think of another album that had been out that long, given up as, you know, a piece of trash in the garbage. And
yeah, to come back like that.
Comes back like that. And people I saw saying on Facebook saying, you know, Breakdown was released in 1976. I'm going, yeah, but yeah,
you understand. Yeah.
76, we re-released in 77, we went to 40 on the charts. And they go, no, it was in 76. Okay, whatever. I get you. You know, you saw it. You know, it's released twice. No, it's only released once. Whatever. I just, you know.
Right.
Romantics.
But I can say reading this book made me, one, dig up that version of Breakdown and listen to it while I'm moving through the chapters. And then as soon as I was done, I was just like, I need to start putting on some more Tom Petty. Which, as far as takeaways from books go, let's be honest, you could do a lot worse.
So true.
That you want to listen to American Girl for the 1001st time to just appreciate it all the more. And, you know,
you hear the little at the front of it goes, shh, shh. Somebody saying in the middle of American Girl. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm talking about? I don't know if you know that.
Yes. Little I'm talking about. It's. Yes.
That was just supposed to be in that song. What? I feel the same way about America. We were going to re-release Breakdown we were going to put American Girl out as a single after we did Breakdown. Because now the people at MCA are coming into my office going,
right.
Okay, John, what are you? And then that's when I went to his house and heard Listen to Her Heart.
That's good.
So go up and guitar lick on and listen to her heart. It's like, we'll kill you.
Mm-hmm.
I made him play it like 7 times. little old reel to reel. And I went back to ABC and they said, well, we're going to put out American Girl as a single. I said, you won't believe what he's got in the studio, in the can.
Mm-hmm.
And so they scrapped American Girl and signed him to a new contract. Because he was out the door and he had signed another contract now with him. And because Tom, he got a raw deal on Shelter. Denny Cordell offered him $10,000 for his publishing. And when Tom got there, Tom had no idea what publishing meant.
Right.
So he was going, well, $10,000, that's, you know, all right, I'll take that. And he was like another kid who just get, you know, these record companies sometimes are just terrible people.
Yeah.
And, you know, you sign up with a record company now and they want everything. They want your t-shirt sales, your concert sales, your record sales, your Spotify, whatever. And it's just foolish. But I'm sorry, I lost it. Sometimes I just get lost in this thing sometimes.
Well, it's just, it's such a magical time. And clearly you like going back there and I completely understand it. And it's a fun journey to tag along.
Yes.
Petty and Me, My Adventures in Rock and Roll with Tom Petty by Jon Scott is available only at Jon's website, tompettyandme.com.
Rock and Roll Grad School is produced by The Professional Production Company. Please be sure to rate and review us on Apple Podcasts, because your impassioned review is just as honest as us standing backstage waiting to come back on for the encore. For more information, you can check out our website, rockandrollgradschool.com. And like everyone else, we're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Today's show was recorded and produced by Heidi Hagquist and myself from our world headquarters located on the second floor of the Professional Office Building, centrally located downtown. Our reluctant executive producers are John Sauve and Sandy Stone. Our willing executive producers are Rachel Allen and Randy Jeanette. Our intern is Zach Jackson. This one's for Philippe. Thanks for joining us. Good night, drive safe, and may all your favorite bands stay together. I gotta feel